Few quick notes. December 6th is my birthday, and the channel is trending to be over 10,000 subscribers within the next 1 to 2 weeks. So we'll be doing some celebratory stuff, stay tuned. But beyond that, let's just get into it. The Battle of Deep Space Nine would be one of the first clashes between Klingon and Federation forces. A decisive tactical victory for Starfleet and Bajoran forces, the Klingons would lose at least 22% of its fleet, meaning at least 11 ships lost and over 5,000 loyal Klingon soldiers killed. The Starfleet Bajoran forces would have at least a dozen dead and many injured, and would lose only a Galor-class ship, the Prakish, that had been rescued by the Defiant. Before we get into the battle proper, let's go ahead and do a breakdown of the ships that would be fielded by both the Federation, Cardassian Union, and Klingon Empire. You can go to the timestamp to bypass it, but I made these just for you, so why not? Plus, I don't repeat the S.H.I.E.L.D. dialogue over and over, so there's that. The Defiant-class starship, publicly classified as an escort vessel, though in reality was one of the first real warships of Starfleet, was developed in 2366. Due to design issues, the ship would initially be mothballed. The Dominion threat would have it again relaunched in 2371. The ship was designed for one purpose, to fight and to kill the Borg. The armaments of the ship allowed it to complement other ships such as the Akura class. This design would allow it to work in tandem with other ships in order to defeat the Borg cube and other Borg ships. The armaments of the ship included phaser cannon assemblies located in forward-facing locations. At least 3 phaser emitters, one placed on the forward and aft of the ship to give full range of attack, as well as one behind the bridge on the dorsal surface. The deflector arrays could also be refitted into a makeshift phaser emitter, though they would only be able to use it once. Defiant-class ships also had a total of up to 6 torpedo launchers, 4 forward and 2 aft. The ship was used extensively both at the Battle of Sector 001 and throughout the Dominion War. The Defiant would become a staple of a post-Dominion War Federation, being used to engage a variety of foes. A Galor-class vessel shared the same basic structure as the Keldon-class, and is the main line of defense for the Cardassian Union. A Galor-class ship could handle up to 300 crew and troops. It had a cruise of warp 8 and maximum warp of 9.6. The ship was observed to have at least up to 4 phasers and disruptors mounted at various points. Some sources claim the ship sported up to 8 or more spiral wave disruptors, one large wave disruptor cannon, and other weapons that could be mounted as necessary, though this has never been observed. Deep Space Nine, originally Tarok Nor, was a Cardassian station built by Bajoran slave labor. A standard crew of Deep Space Nine could be anywhere from 300 members to over 2,000. The maximum capacity of the station was 7,000 people. Originally used to ensure the suppression of the Bajoran people, Deep Space Nine would ultimately become one of the most historic sites and vital interests of both the Bajoran people and the United Federation of Planets. The station is located near the Bajoran wormhole, which connects the Alpha Quadrant with the Gamma Quadrant, and was the site of multiple battles. After the station's refit, it would boast over 48 phasers on rotary mounts, 36 phaser emitters on stationary mounts, 3 phaser emitters on sliding mounts, and 48 torpedo launchers that have over 5,000 photon torpedoes. The Klingon Bird of Prey was a warship of the Klingon Empire that has been in service since the 23rd century in various iterations. The most basic type of this ship has anywhere from 6 to 12 crew and can hold up to 4 prisoners, whereas the cruiser type can hold up to 1,500 crew and troops. The ship has been used as a scout, raider, patrol ship, and cruiser. The different iterations of the ship include the Cavort class, Borel class, and D-12 class. All iterations have been observed with a maximum warp of 8, but the speed can be increased to 9.8 during a slingshot effect, when you literally slingshot around a sun. Most all iterations of the ship would have 2 ship-mounted disruptor cannons, 1 torpedo launcher, and the more advanced ships would sport 4 ship-mounted disruptor cannons and 2 torpedo launchers. The Katinga-class battlecruiser was one of the more powerful ships of the Klingon Defense Force. The ship would have up to 800 crew and a maximum warp of 9.6. In the 23rd century, the ship would be able to challenge a Constitution-class cruiser in an even fight. In a fight, a small number of these ships in a pack could severely damage an Excelsior-class ship. As time would progress, the Katinga would not keep up with current technology and find itself severely outmatched by vessels such as the Galaxy-class starship. Extreme refits would allow the Katinga to continue to be in service, even if at a slight disadvantage due to the age of the design. The vessel would sport up to 6 ship-mounted disruptors and 2 torpedo launchers. In the 2370s, the forward torpedo launchers would also include powerful disruptor emitters. These ships would also be outfitted with concussive charge launchers, though this weapon was generally only seen during the 23rd century. The Vorcha-class starship was the natural successor to the Katinga-class ship. Originally only used for high-ranking officials, it would find itself into general use in the 24th century. The vessel was even once boasted as the flagship of the Klingon Imperial Navy. The ship had a crew of up to 1,900 crew and troops, and could boast warp 9.6. Highly versatile, the ship had 18 ship-mounted disruptor cannons, one large forward disruptor, and up to 3 torpedo launchers. The Negvar-class ship was the most advanced vessel of the Klingon Defense Force in the 24th century. It could accommodate up to 2,500 crew with a warp of 9.6. The ship was massive, and its shape was considered imposing in the Alpha and Beta quadrants. The vessel had over 20 ship-mounted disruptor cannons, one large forward disruptor, and at least 4 torpedo launchers. The Negvar itself was known to be able to stand up to even the most advanced ships that the Federation or other powers could offer. The genesis of the battle can arguably be attributed to Starfleet interventionalism against its former ally. Learning of an invasion fleet that was only 52 hours from Cardassia Prime, Sisko offered safe haven to the D'Etapa Council, the ruling body of the Cardassian Union, on Deep Space Nine. Sisko realized that if the Klingon Empire was able to capture the leaders of the D'Etapa Council, they would be executed and a Klingon overseer installed over the Cardassian Union, effectively ending the regime of the Cardassians. Ironically, this is the same methodology that the Cardassian Union would use to overthrow other governments. Captain Sisko deployed the Defiant under Cloak, against the agreement with the Romulans, by the by, and went into Cardassian space to rendezvous with Gul Dukat, the captain in charge of getting the D'Etapa Council to Deep Space Nine. Sisko would find that Gul Dukat's ship, the Prakish, was under attack by 3 birds of prey and was heavily damaged. Sisko would attempt to call off the Klingon forces, but they would ignore his request. The Defiant would engage the 3 birds of prey, being able to withstand the onslaught far better than the inferior Galor-class ship. A Vorcha-class vessel would enter the battle shortly after the Defiant and begin to fire on both the Defiant and the Prakish. The Defiant would utilize its tractor beam, somehow even though the Klingons had their shields up, and hold the Vorcha-class ship in place so that it could not use its main weapons against the Defiant itself. Sisko would lower shields, transport all surviving crew of the Prakish aboard the Defiant, and then make for Deep Space Nine. The Galor-class ship would explode due to a warp core breach incurred by the heavy damage from the Klingons. The Defiant would be unable to cloak due to damage sustained during the battle and would be trailed by the Vorcha and Birds of Prey. The Defiant and Klingon Tails would arrive at Deep Space Nine, where both would meet a fleet of over 20 to 50 Klingon ships. A Starfleet task force would be on its way, of course, but would not be able to make it in time if the Klingons decided to attack. Martok, at this time a changeling infiltrator posing as a loyal Klingon officer, would contact Benjamin Sisko and order him to surrender the D'Etapa Council or be attacked. Sisko refused, stating that blood tests had been done and the D'Etapa Council was not, in fact, changelings. Chancellor Galron would appear on the view screen stating that it didn't matter, that a Cardassian Union under the control of the Klingon Empire would make the Alpha Quadrant safer. Which, at this point, he probably wasn't wrong. Sisko advised Galron that Deep Space Nine had gone under an extreme refit and was designed to defend against a Dominion fleet, that the Klingons would find themselves in a very difficult battle. With Sisko refusing to hand over the D'Etapa Council, Galron would respond that today was a good day to die and the Klingon fleet would open fire upon their former allies. The Klingon ships would surround the station, attacking its shields from all sides in an attempt to drain them quicker. Sisko would wait for the first wave to get close enough, then fire odd torpedoes, then even torpedoes, and then phasers. This would not only provide maximum damage, but show the station was well defended. With 8 ships destroyed and many, many more damaged, the Klingon fleet was undeterred, continuing to attack the station mercilessly. Resigned that he would not be able to stop this battle, Sisko ordered all weapons free. The station would begin firing all its weapons in tandem, inflicting massive damage upon the Klingon fleet. While they would inflict some damage, the Katinga and Bird of Prey ships would be destroyed almost instantly when hit by the weapons of Deep Space Nine. Understanding that they would need to get onto the station to stop the assault that Deep Space Nine was doing, Martok positioned the Negvar and several other ships, including Vorcha-class, to focus specifically on the station's shields generator. Understanding that they would need to get onto the station to stop its assault upon their fleet, Martok positioned the Negvar and several other ships, including Vorcha-class ships, to focus specifically on the station's shield generators. The Klingons were able to successfully knock out two of the shield generators, bringing down a section of the station's shieldings. Deep Space Nine would be inundated with Klingon boarding parties. The Klingons would beam into Operations, the Promenade, Habitat Ring, and Lower Pylon 3. Though the Klingons would be at a disadvantage, as Federation and Bajoran forces would be fighting on their home turf, using the station's many nooks and crevices to ambush them. The fight in Operations, unlike in Star Trek Discovery, showed a real struggle as trained Klingon officers would put up a real fight against the Starfleet bridge crew. While Deep Space Nine officers in Operations would be able to repel the boarders, they would take heavy casualties and many would be injured. Because that's what happens when you fight Klingons. You get hurt, or you die. Ultimately, the Klingon boarding parties would be contained, though one wondered if they'd be able to hold as such. After defeating the Klingons in Operations, Chief Miles O'Brien would be able to restore the shields to the station. Long-range sensors would pick up multiple warp signatures from opposite sides, but Federation signatures showed that Starfleet vessels were much, much closer. A task force led by Admiral Haster would include the USS Venture, two Excelsior-class ships, one Miranda-class ship, and two other vessels. I'm sure they were Oberths, though we don't know specifically. Ultimately, Kern's words would be prophetic. Galron would realize the Federation was far more capable of defending itself than he first realized. While a victor in the Battle of Deep Space Nine was far from being determined, Galron realized that this would irrevocably weaken the Klingon forces. Galron would cease fire and pull all forces back from Bajoran space. While this battle would not start the Federation-Klingon War, it would be a critical piece leading up to that conflict. The Klingons would continue to be antagonistic towards Starfleet forces from this point on, until the Khitomer Accords would be reinstated. While Starfleet would lose effectively nothing in this battle, it would mark a change in their operations, now finding an ally turned enemy. The Federation would now find a hostile enemy along the Klingon border, an uneasy peace with the Romulans on their border, Cardassian shambles, and of course, the Dominion preparing to attack. In some ways, this would mark how the Alpha Quadrant went from being in relative peace to nothing but conflict until the end of the Dominion War.